Hello everybody, it's Eric here, and in my laboratory today I'm going to be introducing a rather interesting project that I've been working on for the past couple of months. It's very complicated, and there's an awful lot to talk about, but we're going to go over it step by step, inside and out, from everything to the user controls to the internal schematics and theory of operation. So, today I'm very pleased to introduce
the 2020 Intercom System.
Otherwise known as a public address or paging system, a machine like this would typically be found in a place like a school building, an office complex, or a retail space. Normally, they'd amplify background music or be used for making general announcements. This machine in particular has a microphone input and 8 selectable speaker outputs. It's designed to be wired up to different rooms of a house. Unlike an ordinary audio amplifier, it has a neat little trick that it can do. At the flip of a switch, it can operate in reverse. That is, it can use the external speakers as microphones, and this enables the operator to have two-way communication between themselves and a person in another room. In fact, this machine was designed to be relatively simple to operate. So for this next part, let's move everything over to the workbench. We'll take a closer look at the external controls, inputs, outputs, and we'll discuss everything there is to know about how it works.
One thing that immediately stands out about the project are these 3D printed faceplates. 3D printing technology is such an amazing thing. After measuring a few dimensions, deciding on the overall layout, and drawing up the design on some CAD software, I was able to print these faceplates with not only the exact hole spacings and diameters required, but I was even able to incorporate raised lettering, which I then carefully painted, and I think turned out very nicely. Since the faceplates also act as stencils, marking and drilling the holes in the enclosure was a piece of cake. Now let's talk about the controls. On the left side, we have 2 horizontal rows of knobs, switches, and a multicolor status LED. The top row of toggle switches are used for selecting between the 8 different room speakers. On the bottom row, we have the main power switch and 3 knobs. The one on the far right is the master volume control for the amplifier, and this knob is used for adjusting the sensitivity of the operator microphone, which plugs into this quarter-inch TRS jack. Specifically, it varies the gain level of the preamp section. Next, we have a 3-position rotary switch, which sets the input mode of the system. In the page position, the intercom will default to its listening state, and this is the reverse mode that I was talking about before. Whichever speaker is selected will be treated as a microphone and amplified onto the built-in monitor speaker. In the auxiliary position, the system will accept a standard line-level audio signal from a cable plugged into this 3.5mm audio jack, just like any ordinary amplifier would do. This final position is called system mode. On the back side of the machine, there are a couple of binding posts for attaching speaker wires from another sound system as a signal input. This mode is actually pretty handy. Say, for instance, I'm listening to a music or a podcast on my main sound system, and I want to hear it in another room or just go outside. All I have to do is flip a switch, and I can send that audio anywhere I want. The intercom reamplifies the sound onto any of the selected speakers. No matter what mode is selected, pressing the talk switch will immediately cause the operator microphone to be amplified onto the room speakers. In page mode, this is used for alternating back and forth between talking and listening. It's also a pretty rare type of switch. I had to special order it for this project because I wanted it to have a rather unique mechanical action. That is, it's momentary in the down direction, center off, and latching in the upward direction. That way, if you want to make a long speech, you really don't have to hold it down the whole time. Now, of course, it wouldn't be a true intercom system if it didn't make beeping noises. Located on the top panel are 2 signal tone generator buttons. pressing either of these buttons will trigger the machine to briefly emit a series of distinctive tones, which are meant to capture the attention of the person on the receiving end, as well as to signal the beginning and end of conversations or announcements. To avoid clipping distortion at high volume levels, in addition to the monitor speaker, this LED bar graph display is a helpful indicator of the output level of the amplifier. On the back side of the machine, power enters through a standard IEC-style detachable power cord connector and passes through this illuminated fuse holder. If for whatever reason the fuse were to blow, a little neon light inside would glow to indicate the fault. Between these two terminal strips are where the different room speakers are connected. The bottom row is all connected together or common, and the top terminals are numbered corresponding to the selector switches on the front panel. These two binding posts are for attaching the speaker-level signal wires for the system input mode, the green one being grounded. Directly above is a little switch. This changes between a high and a low volume setting for the front monitor speaker. And lastly, this RCA connector is a line-level output of any audio being amplified by the system.
Alright, so we've established the external controls. For this next part, I'm going to grab the power cable, the speakers, and the microphone, hook everything up, and we'll demonstrate the machine operating.
Alrighty, I've got it all set up. I've also dimmed the lights in the room a bit so we can see the LEDs better. So let's power it on. As you can see, the status LED is red. This means the intercom is in the listening state of page mode. This loudspeaker, which I've already selected on switch number 1, is now acting as a microphone input. And the sound is coming out of the monitor. If I press the talk switch, the light turns green. And now, the microphone acts as the input, and the sound comes out of the loudspeaker. When I let go, it goes back to the listening state. If I turn the mode selector switch to the auxiliary position, the status LED turns purple, and for the system input mode, it's blue. Right now, I don't have anything connected to either of these inputs, so let's switch back to the auxiliary mode. I'll grab my phone, connect it up, and we'll do a demonstration. Alright, so there is the auxiliary input mode. Now, of course, the microphone on my camera has some automatic volume leveling, so you're really not getting the full experience, but believe me, it's awfully loud. Next, let's pretend like this speaker is located in another room, and we want to make some sort of an announcement using the signal tone buttons. For a simple announcement, it really makes no difference which input mode is selected. I'll start by pressing button A, followed by
the talk switch, and when I'm finished saying what I need to say or want to end the conversation, I release the talk switch
and press button B. That's all there is to it.
To really give an idea what it's like to listen to someone speaking, I've placed a speaker on my front porch about 20 feet ahead of me. And you're watching me live through a security camera. Now this concludes the demonstration portion of the video. So for the remainder, we'll head back inside and we'll take a look at the internal circuitry.
With the cover lifted off, inside the machine is a densely packed assortment of different circuit modules, with some special attention applied to cable management as well. Each module is attached to the chassis by its own custom-fitted, 3D-printed support base, and most wire connections between modules are facilitated by little screw terminals, rather than being permanently soldered together. This made it significantly easier to hook everything up. And additionally, if any particular circuit ever needed to be modified or serviced, it's not too big of a hassle to unscrew and detach it. From this vantage point, we can see the general layout of things. So let's do a quick overview of all the major parts. First, we have the AC power cord connector with built-in RF noise filter, the fuse holder, and a 60-watt switch mode power supply. This supply will accept anything between 90 and 250 volts AC input and outputs 18 volts at 3.35 amps to the regulator module. The regulator module then outputs both 18 and 12 volt power to the rest of the system circuitry. Above is the audio power amplifier module with its two large heat sinks and the tone generator module. A ribbon cable connects the room speaker selector switches to the rear terminal strip, and lying underneath the cable is the resistor module and microphone preamp module. On the top cover, we can see the display module, as well as some patches of blue acoustic foam. And last but not least is the brain of the system, the control module. This very important module is responsible for acting as a central audio signal junction, quickly rerouting inputs and outputs to and from the amplifier stages, input jacks, and all of the system speakers. In addition to routing signals, the control module can also modify the gain settings of the preamp, apply frequency filtering to audio signals, and change the colors of the status LED depending on the current mode of operation. However, to properly explain how the control module does what it does, and how it works at the component level, we first need to closely examine the schematics and operational theories of a few of the other surrounding circuits. Many of these circuits are loaded with subtle nuances, but I'll try my best to focus on the most important design aspects. With that said, let's move on to our first circuit, the microphone preamplifier. The Canakit CK494 microphone preamp is one of two modules in the project that were ordered in PCB soldering kit format. This circuit is relatively simple and only has two transistors. The schematic is a fairly textbook example of a two-stage, common emitter, complementary pair cascade amplifier configuration. It is capable of amplifying the very weak microvolt level signal of a dynamic microphone up to a maximum output amplitude of approximately 4 volts peak-to-peak, which is more than enough to drive the couple hundred millivolts needed for the line-level input stage of a standard audio amplifier. For example, when a positive going signal is applied to the input, it is capacitively coupled by capacitor C1 onto the resistor voltage bias network and base of NPN transistor Q1. When the base voltage of Q1 is made slightly more positive, base current flow increases and Q1 is driven further into conduction, increasing the collector current and pulling the collector voltage closer to ground. The collector of Q1 is directly connected to the base of PNP transistor Q2. Being a PNP transistor, when the base of Q2 is pulled more negative, the base current increases and drives Q2 further into conduction, increasing collector current and pulling the collector voltage even more substantially positive. Finally, the twice amplified signal is capacitively coupled via C4 to the output to remove any DC bias. Note that the input and output signals are actually in phase. The 22 microfarad capacitors C2 and C3 are for emitter AC current bypassing. C0 is an added capacitor mounted in socket pins. This is a modification to the original circuit. I found that by adding a small capacitor to the input, we could remove a significant amount of EMF noise that's picked up from long room speaker wires. This diagram illustrates the complete schematic of the preamp module, as well as the external wiring to parts of the control module and gain level potentiometers. The original kit was set up to have a single potentiometer to adjust the final gain setting. However, depending on whether it's amplifying a signal coming from the operator microphone or a room speaker acting as a microphone, we need to be able to change the gain setting to compensate for these different scenarios. To accomplish this, two separate potentiometers are wired up in a parallel configuration. One is physically located on the control module for the room speaker setting, and the other is attached to the front panel for the operator microphone. A relay on the control module selects between the two signal levels present on the different potentiometer wipers and returns the result back to the preamp module. It's worth noting that the control module was designed and assembled long before the preamp kit and exact schematic details were obtained for the project. Therefore, the control module had to be designed to be able to universally interface with any preamplifier circuit with a gain control potentiometer, regardless of its placement within the actual circuit topology. Incidentally, due to the way this particular kit is set up, the signal ends up going from the preamp to the control module, back to the preamp, and directly back to the control module again. Though it may seem a bit silly at first, this arrangement could potentially allow the preamp to be upgraded to a different model in the future, if I ever decided to do that, and it wouldn't require much effort to make the swap. But anyway, now that we've created an audio signal at a useful amplitude, we can pass it on to the next stage, the audio power amplifier. The Canakit CK193 mono audio amplifier was also supplied in the form of a PCB kit. At the heart of it are an identical pair of TDA-2003 linear amplifier ICs, which I've fitted with some much larger heat sinks than the ones that came with the original kit to help improve performance. This amplifier module can deliver between 25 to 30 watts RMS at the speaker output. The heat sinks can get up to about 150 Fahrenheit, which is definitely hot to the touch, but no problem whatsoever for the chips. Here, we can see a simplified example of a single TDA-2003 amplifier in a standard application configuration. Internally, it's considered to be a Class AB type amplifier. With no signal applied, the output voltage will naturally rest at exactly half of the supply voltage, and when amplifying a signal, the output can vary anywhere between just below the positive supply and just above ground potential. In order to properly power a speaker, a DC blocking capacitor is required to allow only the AC portion of the output to pass through. The maximum instantaneous voltage seen across the speaker can never exceed slightly less than half of the supply voltage, so this does put a considerable limit on the amount of power it can deliver. To overcome this problem, though, a second amplifier may be added to the circuit, and the speaker connected directly between the two outputs. This setup is what's known as a bridged configuration. Since the resting voltage difference between the two amplifiers is now essentially zero, no DC blocking capacitor is needed. The second amplifier is also driven inversely to the first. When one amplifier output approaches the positive supply, the other output approaches ground potential to an equal extent, or vice versa, thereby effectively supplying the speaker with almost the full supply voltage. When the voltage applied to the speaker is doubled, the resulting current flow will double, and the total power delivered to the speaker is quadrupled. The actual circuit schematic for the module is not very complicated, and most of the heavy lifting is being done by the amplifier chips. To begin, 18-volt DC power is supplied to the circuit and immediately filtered by electrolytic capacitor C8 and polyester film capacitor C3 before entering amplifiers U1 and U2. The line-level input audio signal is fed straight to and adjusted by the master volume potentiometer P1. And capacitively coupled through C2 before entering the non-inverting input of amplifier U1. The amplified, non-inverted output appears on pin 4, where it then connects to the plus speaker terminal, as well as passing through resistors R3 and R2 to ground. The midpoint between R3 and R2 forms a voltage divider, that is capacitively coupled by C1 to the inverting input on pin 2, forming a negative feedback loop that controls the gain of the IC. This same R2, R3 midpoint signal is passed through R1 and coupled by C4 to the inverting input of amplifier U2. The non-inverting input of U2 is referenced to ground by C5. The output of U2 is directly connected to the minus speaker terminal. The gain setting of U2 is also set through negative feedback via R4, C4, and inverting input pin 2. R5, R6, C6, and C7 are only there to prevent unwanted oscillations from occurring when driving inductive loads at high frequencies. With an 18-volt supply, the maximum voltage this circuit can apply across the speaker output is approximately 16 volts. This diagram illustrates the complete schematic of the audio amp module, as well as the external wiring connections for the input section, volume control, speaker outputs, and power supply. The master volume control potentiometer is actually separated from the module and located on the front panel. Also shown are the input signal connections shared by the rear line-out port and display module. However, there is one very important factor yet to be discussed. When used as part of an intercom system, this amplifier is going to have to be able to handle being connected to multiple speakers at the same time. A single TDA-2003 in the standard configuration is rated for driving an impedance as low as 1.6 ohms. However, in a bridged configuration with double the output voltage, this minimum impedance rating must also be doubled to 3.2 ohms. In a worst-case scenario, 8 8-ohm speakers wired in parallel presents a total impedance of only 1 ohm. So to avoid overwhelming the amplifier with such a heavy load, it becomes necessary to introduce some extra resistance in series to limit the current flow to within reasonable boundaries. This task is accomplished by the resistor module. The resistor module consists of 4 5-watt power resistors connected in a series parallel arrangement. It has 6 pins with 2 jumpers that can be rearranged in 8 different patterns to fine-tune the series resistance to the exact value needed to reach the target 3.2 ohms. Ideally, the intercom would be installed using higher impedance 16 to 32 ohm range speakers in smaller rooms to increase the total impedance, minimize the needed resistance, and maximize efficiency. Note that the connection leading to the lower room speaker terminal strip on the back of the machine passes through this module due to its physical location on the chassis. This module connects in series between the non-inverting speaker output of the amplifier module and the control module. Now that we've explored the inner operating principles of the preamp, audio amp, and resistor module, we can finally move on to the parts that tie everything together and make the whole system work. Behold, the master schematic for the system chassis and control module. This complete schematic details all of the components and wired connections of the control module and system chassis. The portion shaded in green is all contained within the control module itself. Up at the top is the entire power section. It consists of the RF noise filter with a common mode choke, illuminated fuse holder, power supply, and regulator module. The live voltage wire exits the noise filter, passes through the power switch and fuse holder, and enters the switch mode power supply. The neutral line goes directly to the supply. 18 volts DC is provided by the power supply, where it flows into the regulator module, which is literally just 3 capacitors and a 12-volt regulator. Next, we can see most of the audio-related circuit modules shaded in blue. And in the top right corner are the room speaker terminal strips and selector switches. Originally, when I first laid out the initial design for the project, the intercom system only consisted of the power section, preamp, audio amp, resistor module, and control module. The display module and signal tone generator were actually added on later. To explain how the control module works, for the sake of clarity, we can go ahead and remove them from the schematic for now. We'll get back to them later. I'll also go ahead and omit the power section, as well as simplify the resistor module and get rid of the borders. I suppose it's also worth noting that the contacts on all six of the control module relays are being shown in their resting positions. However, as soon as power is applied, one or more of these relays will always be activated, so this particular system state never actually occurs. To get started, just like the demonstration portion of the video, let's begin with the listening state of the paging mode, where the room speaker acts as a microphone and the signal is amplified onto the monitor speaker. First, we need to select whichever room speaker we want to use. I'll switch on speaker number 8. When the mode switch is set to the page position, a 12-volt power signal flows across the normally closed contacts of relay 4 and through the mode switch, lighting the red portion of the status LED via a signal steering diode and series 520 ohm resistor, and energizes relay 3. Relay 3 performs two functions at the same time. It switches the preamp gain setting to the wiper of the room potentiometer located on the control module itself, and additionally allows the high side of the selected room speaker to connect to the input of the preamp. With relay 6 being in its resting state, one side of its contacts connect the lower, common room speaker terminals to ground. The line level output of the preamp passes through the normally closed contacts of relay 5 and the bandpass filter section before reaching the input of the audio amp. I'll get to the bandpass filter section after a bit. It's actually pretty important. Next, the other set of contacts on relay 6 pass the non-inverting output of the audio amp directly to the monitor speaker. This also bypasses the monitor high and low level switch resistors for greater volume. The inverting amplifier output is permanently connected to the monitor speaker. Since the monitor speaker is fairly small, some capacitance is always in series with it to help restrict the lowermost frequencies from getting through. Altogether, the room speaker acts as a microphonic input to the preamp, and the room audio is fully amplified onto the monitor. Pressing the talk switch sends power directly to the coil of relay 4, lights the green LED with a 680 ohm resistor, and energizes relay 6 through a signal steering diode. The contacts of relay 4 open, cutting power to the other LEDs and the mode switch. This is why it doesn't matter what mode is selected when the talk switch is being pressed. Relays 1, 2, 3, and 5 cannot receive power and default to their resting positions. Relay 3 connects the input of the preamp to the operator microphone and switches the preamp gain setting to the wiper of the mic potentiometer located on the front panel. The output of the preamp is connected to the bandpass filter and audio amp input by the normally closed contacts of relay 5. With relay 6 being active, the non-inverting output of the audio amp is directed to the high side of the room speaker terminals, and the inverting output is connected to the lower common side. A small amount of the signal also reaches the monitor speaker through one of the two resistors set by the monitor level switch. To that effect, the monitor is always partially connected to the output of the amplifier. The end result is that the operator microphone is now fully amplified onto the room speaker and partially audible on the monitor speaker. While still in the page mode, this single switch allows the intercom system to rapidly alternate back and forth between the talking and listening states. One little side note as well, down on the bottom left, there are a couple of resistors and a capacitor involved in the talk switch circuit. These components were added to slightly slow the switching times of relays 4 and 6. This prevents some transient popping noises on the amplifier when the relay coils disconnect. Next, let's flip the mode switch into the auxiliary position. In the auxiliary input mode, power flows from relay 4 through the mode switch and into both the red and the blue portions of the status LED via some signal diodes and series resistors. Additionally, relays 2, 5, and 6 are activated. Relay 5 switches a portion of the circuit referred to as the line level signal bus onto the bandpass filter and audio amp input. Relay 2 connects the auxiliary input signal onto the signal bus. And relay 6 switches the output of the audio amp to the room speakers. Therefore, amplified audio is supplied to the room speakers and is audible on the monitor. The status LED color combination is purple. Putting the mode selector switch into the system input mode causes almost exactly the same circuit actions as the auxiliary mode, except that relay 1 applies the audio signal to the signal bus rather than relay 2, and the red LED does not receive power, so the status LED color is blue. A high-value series resistor reduces the incoming speaker-level signal to a range suitable for the input of the amplifier. The resistor is mounted in socket pins on the control module to allow the general gain relationship of this mode to be readjusted in the future if necessary. Now let's talk about that bandpass filter section. The audio bandpass filter section of the system also includes the volume control potentiometer. Its purpose is to optimize the system for maximum loudness and sound quality on small to medium-sized speakers without wasting unnecessary power driving frequencies they cannot effectively reproduce. This mathematical model depicts the equivalent bandpass filter circuit and an approximate output frequency response curve. The low-end cutoff frequency is set at about 300 Hz, and the high-end cutoff is at roughly 30 kHz, which is well beyond human hearing range, but serves to effectively remove RF interference. The amplitude of the bass frequency components of most music, voice, and general audio signals are normally considerably larger than that of the mid-range and treble frequencies. These lowermost frequencies are usually the first to cause clipping distortion at high volume levels due to their high dynamic range. Filtering out the excessive bass frequency peaks allows the frequencies most important to human speech to be amplified significantly more than before. Therefore, the overall performance of the intercom system is massively improved. That's it for the control module. So now it's time to move on to the signal tone module we omitted earlier. This circuit sits directly in line with the signal path between the control module and the input to the audio amplifier. It connects to the buttons on the top cover with a detachable cable and also taps into the talk switch circuit and the red LED. When the module is not active, it acts just like a wire and has no effect on anything at all. However, when triggered by either of the buttons, it works by temporarily hijacking the system, injecting an oscillator waveform into the amplifier and commanding the control module to direct the output onto the speakers. Here is the module schematic. It consists of a classic 555 timer circuit in an A-stable multivibrator configuration to form the oscillator section. The frequency is dictated by an RC time constant. In the middle are two relays. One relay is responsible for sending power to the oscillator and control circuitry and routing the amplifier input signal path. The other relay changes the oscillator frequency by altering the RC time constant. Below are two MOSFET transistors, which switch the relays on and off. Here's how it works. 12 volts DC sits on capacitor C4 between both relay coils and one side of relay 2's contacts, and in common with both buttons. When button A is pressed, current flows through a limiting resistor and quickly charges the capacitors connected to the gates of both transistors. This voltage on the gates puts both transistors into full conduction, which powers on both relays. Relay 2 sends power to the oscillator,
the red LED, and talk switch circuit of the control module, as if the talk switch were being pressed. The green LED also lights up, and the color combination is yellow. Simultaneously, relay 1 connects a pair of resistors in parallel with the existing resistors on the oscillator timing circuit, which decreases the RC time constant and raises the frequency. The 12-volt square wave output of the oscillator passes through an integrator circuit, which converts the 12-volt square wave into a few hundred millivolt triangle wave. This signal is capacitively coupled to remove the DC bias, adjusted by a potentiometer, and passed directly to the amplifier. When the button is released, the voltages on the MOSFET capacitors begin to bleed off to ground through parallel resistors. However, the resistor on relay 1 has a lower value, so the voltage drops more quickly. When the MOSFET gate voltage falls below the threshold needed to maintain conduction, relay 1 turns off and the oscillator frequency drops. Relay 2 remains switched on for a short period of time, until finally letting go, stopping the oscillator, releasing the system controls, and reconnecting the amplifier input to the control module. The whole cycle lasts about 1.5 seconds, and the intercom emits a doorbell-like signal tone. When button B is pressed, current flows through another limiting resistor, but this time it encounters a Zener diode, which clamps the voltage down to 5.6 volts. This voltage passes through diode D4, is blocked from the other circuit by D3, and charges the capacitor to only 4.9 volts, which still turns on the transistor. Relay 2 powers on the oscillator, reconfigures the amplifier input, and overrides the system controls just like before. But when the button is released, the MOSFET gate capacitor voltage falls below the switching threshold much faster, and shuts off the whole thing in about half a second. The system only emits a brief single frequency tone. At this point, the only thing left to cover is the display module. This module is connected to the input section of the audio amplifier directly off of the signal coming from the wiper of the volume control potentiometer. It is constructed from a double-sided protoboard and mounted beneath a diffuser on the top cover of the machine with a detachable cable. The schematic is relatively simple and is based on an LM3914 IC, which is specifically made for driving LED bar graph displays. A regulator steps down the 18-volt supply to 5 volts for the module, and the audio signal is applied to pin 5 of the chip. Internally, it uses a set of comparators to compare the voltage of the audio signal to a 10-way resistive voltage divider network. It has a linear response. A potentiometer calibrates the display by setting the uppermost voltage level on the divider to the input saturation voltage of the amplifier, at which the output begins to exhibit clipping. The other end is tied to ground. A single resistor from pin 7 to ground sets the regulated output current for the LED drivers. A mode jumper switches the display to either a solid bar or floating dot style output. The two LED arrays are wired electrically parallel, but physically mirrored horizontally, for an interesting visual effect.
I think it looks pretty cool, but does serve a purpose. After all, in the case of an intercom system with the main speakers located far away in different rooms, it could otherwise be pretty difficult to properly adjust the volume level without some form of visual indicator.
And with that, we have successfully covered every part of the intercom system schematic. This concludes our journey through this mighty little machine. We've covered every inch of the design, and I could go on and on, but we'll leave it at that.